Well, good morning.
Good morning.
I mean, lots of sports things to mention here. If anyone wants to talk about the Yankees, feel free to talk now. Okay, which is all like so. Then I think it's deserved coming towards me. Really, the only thing I wanted to mention was Texas A&M. So the only real fun game yesterday in my mind. So Stevens families and all the others representing Texas A&M enjoyed that game yesterday. One announcement today. There's really only one game we're mentioning, Larry, from this. I mean, this is why I'm controlling the announcements here today, and these announcements are about Texas A&M only, although I've been already tortured by the children to talk about the Yankees, so I figured I'd give them a shot. Okay, so the one lone announcement that I have is the Reformation Festival is next Saturday, 1 o'clock. We've invited the community. We went out on Facebook. We did our post. We pushed it to be able to hit more people. So the community is invited. We don't know who will come, but the Lord knows, and we will rejoice and whoever attends in that. But what that means is we need people to sign up for booths. So it's 1 to 5 next Saturday. We need a bunch of booths. So if you have not yet signed up for a booth, this is the last week. I know the procrastination, you know, runs through many of our veins. This is it. There's no longer any more time. We have to sign up. And so this week, please sign up for a booth. Bring candy or whatever else, you know what I mean, as little prizes. Let's just have a lot of fun for the community as we celebrate a watershed moment in the history of the Christian church. That's my only announcement. Dan, anything to add on that?
We are going to stick around afterwards and eat together, and so we'll be planning food. You can sign up for food also, and so, yeah.
Good. Okay. Any other announcements from the body that anyone wants to share or needs to share? Okay. If not, let's just go before our Father in heaven. Father, we thank you, Lord, for this day. We thank you, Lord, for loving us. We thank you, Father, for your grace and your mercy that you shower upon us so freely, so undeservedly, Lord. I thank you, Father, for a nation like this that we can gather together. We can worship you freely. We can open up your word and honor you today. Father, we do ask that you would just help us to worship you this morning in spirit and in truth, for we ask this in the name of Jesus. Amen. Church, we are in the Heidelberg Catechism. If we could pull up the question. Question number 41. Does anybody have the question memorized? What is the question? Why was he buried? Excellent. And the answer, what is the answer? To prove that he was really dead. Together, church, why was Jesus buried? To prove that he was really dead. Amen. Simple one for this month. That's great. Great job. Please stand up. Let's worship God in song.
Your grace is enough.
than just a scout, Jacob. Use the weak to lead the strong. Lead us in the song of your salvation. All your people sing. Priceless blood has ransomed me. Mine was the sin that drove the bitterness and hung him on that judgment tree. I will glory in my Redeemer who crushed the power of sin and death. My only Savior before the glory in my Redeemer, my life he bought, my love he owed. I have no longings for another, I'm satisfied in him alone. I will glory in my Redeemer, his faithfulness, my standing place. Foes of mine and rush upon me. Feet are firm held by his grace. Feet are firm held by his grace. As I will glory in carries me on eagle's wing. He crowns my life in loving kindness. His triumph song I'll ever sing. I will glory in my Redeemer who waits for me at gates of old. When he calls me, it will be paradise. forever to behold. His face forever to behold.
Try that in a different key.
How God he bridged the great divide to offer us eternal life. Sending hope within a man. His love never fails. His love never ends. He came in flesh to fight our cause. With power to tame the ocean's roar, taking on our sin and shame, he opened up the way, he overcame the grave. Once for all, our King has paid. Glory to his name, Jesus.
all the glory to his name, Jesus. All the glory to his
church. Please be seated.
Church, we're going to have a time of prayer here now, and just ask that you take the next several minutes and go before our Father in heaven. And you can pray by yourself. You can pray as a family. You can link up and even pray with other families if you like. And you can spread out all over these rooms because we're going to take several minutes and go before our Father. Pastor Dan and myself will be up front. If any of you would like for either one of us to pray with you, we're available to do that. We love to do that. Don't hesitate to come forward. It's part of what we really cherish. So don't even hesitate. And then after several minutes, I'll close this corporately in prayer. Thanks. Heavenly Father, we just ask that the words of our mouths, the meditations of our heart might be pleasing, Lord, in your sight in this place. For you are our rock and you're our redeemer. Father, we pray for Pastor Dan as he comes forward now, that as he opens up your word and seeks to communicate the truths contained therein, Father, that you would give him a courage and a boldness to speak forth clearly, that you'd give each of us in the congregation, including Pastor Dan himself, to receive that truth, to find itself implanted as a seed in our hearts, that it might bear fruit some 30, some 60, some 90-fold, Father, all for your glory and never for our own. Be glorified, Lord, we ask in this place, in this time, for we ask it all in the name of Jesus. Amen.
Well, good morning, church. I'm going to say something to you that I think you may have thought I would never say to you, and that's turn to Exodus chapter 21. If you were keeping score like I was, I put a letter behind each sermon when we're in a chapter, so Exodus 20A through whatever, and we were at N when we finished chapter 20. That doesn't usually happen, but it was a good trip through Exodus 20, and so we're looking forward to what else we find out here in the weeks ahead in Exodus. There are a lot of areas where the Bible is misunderstood. There are many verses that are taken and misquoted or used out of context. This is often done to discredit the Word of God in a debate or an argument. A person who wants to prove that God is not good, for example, or that he's less than God-like, will take a portion of Scripture and twist it to match up with what they're trying to prove. And there's probably not a greater set of issues, honestly, that are misunderstood than those before us today. That is the biblical version of slavery and the cultural treatment of women in the Scripture. These issues are often used to try and prove that God is not truly good. God thinks of women poorly and allows them to be treated poorly. And so, even though this is admittedly an unusual place to settle on to do a sermon, I never probably would have picked this on my own except for reading through some of my commentaries. I think there's some very important lessons for us here. And I also think that it proves for us that every portion of God's Word is important. There's something in every single part that speaks to us today. And we're wise to study all of it. And today in the passage, God is outlining for Moses the treatment of slaves of all kinds. He gives, once again, very specific instructions for how a slave is to be treated, how they're to be released, how they are to be fed and cared for while they are in custody. And in doing this, we begin to see a clear picture of a God who is not evil or uncaring, but a God who loves the slave and the slaveholder alike. We'll also learn a bit about the nature of slavery in the Bible and how it completely differs from the slavery in the early years in our country. Let's look together at verse 1 of chapter 21. Now, these are the rules that you shall set before them. When you buy a Hebrew slave, he shall serve 6 years, and in the seventh he shall go out free for nothing. These verses here begin what is called the Book of the Covenant, according to chapter 24 of Exodus. This Book of the Covenant is a set of rules that outline the specific social context of the Ten Commandments. How then shall we live after we've been given these commandments? God is bringing all of this down, condensing it all down to ground level so that they can understand. one of the criticisms of the Book of the Covenant is that there are instances of these very same rules in earlier cultures. The criticism is that Israel has just simply copied others with their laws. And this is brought out to try and discredit the authority of the Bible itself. For example, the Code of Hammurabi, perhaps you've heard of that, from 1700 BC, is the code of conduct for the Babylonians. It contains rules which are almost identical to the Book of the Covenant in places. And as I said, some have used this to make the claim that Israel simply stole their set of rules from Babylon, because Moses wrote these words around 1450 BC, give or take. But the truth of the matter is, God speaks to his people in their vernacular, first of all, and the cultural references that they will understand. He speaks to them so they understand. They understood what he was telling them because he spoke to them in this fashion. So never mind if another culture came up with the same code of conduct. What's more likely in these other cultures coming up with the same set of rules is that this is evidence instead of man being made in the image of God. There's a sense of right and wrong that comes from him, from his image. So these other cultures were simply recreating what was inside of them to begin with. Romans chapter 1 speaks about the law of God being written on every single man's heart so that they are without excuse. So God's not copying anyone here. They're copying him. We see here in the first few verses that emancipation is built into this arrangement. Both slave and slaveholder alike know going in that this arrangement is for 6 years maximum. On the seventh year, the principle of the Sabbath year and the principle of Jubilee kicks in. Now, these principles are going to be given to Moses at a later date in Leviticus 25. Every seventh year, the Jews were to let the land rest. They were to grow no crops at all. And the question is answered about what it is that they're going to eat during that year in Leviticus 25. If you say, "What shall we eat in the seventh year, if we may not sow or gather in our crop, I will command my blessing on you in the sixth year, so that it will produce a crop sufficient for 3 years." Now, this is not unlike God's requirement related to manna that they're currently eating and harvesting, where they rest on the seventh day from gathering. When they take the promised land a bit later, they will allow the land to rest every 7 years. And then every 50 years, 7 times 7, that next year, they have a year of Jubilee. And in Jubilee, all the debts are forgiven. Each clan goes back to their own home property. And once again, the land is allowed to rest. And so this command of God to release slaves after 6 years coincides with the Sabbath year. There would not be any sowing and reaping going on that year anyway, and so there's no need for servants to work the fields necessarily. And you get to see in all of this the provision of the Lord. You get to see the goodness of God in his provision of 3 years' worth of crops in 1 year. There's abundance, there is rest, there is freedom when things are done God's way. Look at verse 3. If he comes in single, he shall go out single. If he comes in married, then his wife shall go out with him. Now, when the slave is released, we get some important instructions about how they are to go. If they are married going in, then they will remain married as they are released. And this is a way of showing us that God values the marriage covenant as well. He values the marriage of slaves just as he does other marriages. Verse 4. If his master gives him a wife, and she bears him sons or daughters, the wife and her children shall be her master's, and he shall go out alone. Now, this is one of the first places here where a misunderstanding of the process can occur. And it gives us a chance to discuss the entire process as well. You may be saying, wait a minute, I thought God valued marriage. Now here we have him sending the guy out alone if the wife belonged to the master to begin with. It is true that God instructs the wives of these unions as well as the children to stay with the master at this point. But this is not the final word in all of this. First of all, we must understand a bit about the situation, the slave's situation. The slave became a slave because of his own debt. Slavery was completely voluntary during this time. If a man became a slave, he is the one who sought it out in order to satisfy debt that he had incurred. And so it was essentially the sinfulness of this man, the slave who became a slave, that caused him to seek this out to begin with. It was because he didn't handle his own finances well as he should have in that situation. If the man took his wife and children with him when he left, for example, and he began to act just like he acted before, he began to get in debt and he acted in a worthless fashion, then he would have this family and no way to take care of them. God is designing a way to protect this wife and these children and to see how the man's going to do when he's free. If he gets out and he works and he pays his bills, he saves up some money, he can go to this slave owner and redeem his wife and children according to the rules that are set up later by God in Scripture. Then they all walk away free. The man has proven out that he's trustworthy and can make it on his own. And if he can't do that, then the wife and children are protected by the slaveholder. Once again, instead of the severity of God, we see here his goodness. Instead of a problem with something, we see that God has thought of everything. This is the reason that we study passages like these. They point to the attributes of God in a way that we may not have seen before. And this is the beginning of the discussion on how biblical slavery differs from American slavery. Again, these men in biblical times sought out becoming slaves. A better term for what they were would actually be a servant rather than a slave. They were much more like our modern-day employee, and the slaveholder was much more like our modern-day employer. This was voluntary. That's the first key point. Second key point, that's not covered here, but just shortly after, involuntary slavery was forbidden. In verse 16, which we'll cover later, it says, "Whoever steals a man and sells him, and anyone found in possession of him shall be put to death." That verse by itself rules out the practices of slavery in Africa and the West as unlawful in the sight of God. By God's law, those men who stole other men from Africa, brought them to America against their will, should have been put to death. All of the mental wrangling that Americans have done in the past to try and justify what happened here is disallowed on this verse alone. There's no way to justify what happened here in this country. Regardless of whether or not the slaves were treated well by their masters in America, whether or not they stayed on with their masters after emancipation, the whole enterprise was illegal in God's eyes. Further, according to God's law, those slaves should have been freed in the seventh year if the Bible was used to try and justify what they were doing here in our country. And the third important fact in this is what Deuteronomy 15 ends up telling us. It says, if your brother, a Hebrew man or Hebrew woman, is sold to you, he shall serve you 6 years, and in the seventh year you shall let him go free from you. And when you let him go free from you, you shall not let him go empty-handed. You shall furnish him liberally out of your flock, out of your threshing floor, and out of your winepress. As the Lord your God has blessed you, you shall give to him. You shall remember that you were a slave in the land of Egypt, and the Lord your God redeemed you. Therefore, I command you this today. So we see here that a slave is to be sent away in the seventh year, basically set up to have his own house, his own livelihood. This whole enterprise begins to look more like a rehabilitation of this slave to land on his feet. It was an apprenticeship to show them how to live debt-free. And their wife and children would be kept in safekeeping for them when they were initially turned out to ensure that the man did okay on his own. And if he did, then he could buy back his family from the master. So you can see in this a couple of things. You can see that this doesn't resemble American slavery in the least. So the criticisms of God and the biblical account regarding slavery are unfounded completely. God's not advocating for slavery like we had. And second, you can see the goodness and the grace and the benevolence of a loving Heavenly Father in the whole situation from start to finish. This is about rehab. This is about lowering repeat offenses. This is about creating responsibility in the man being set free. I tell you, there are so many very good principles here that if used in our current society for prisoners being turned loose, for debtors being handled, I would submit that it would create a different society for us. The lesson for us is this: when you do things God's way, He blesses the outcome. He keeps His promises to people by protecting women and children, by providing abundance in the years of Sabbath rest. He teaches a man who may have made some mistakes earlier in life to be a responsible member of our society. He shows His love and His compassion, His concern for every single player in this scene. And so the criticisms that are placed on the Bible for promoting slavery are a complete misunderstanding of the institution of slavery in the Scripture. There's no way they can possibly understand what was being done here because there's no room for criticism. God is making absolutely sure that everybody's being taken care of. Employees are providing for the welfare of their workers. Nothing wrong with that. And those that used the Scripture in the past to justify the slavery in our country, I believe, are misquoting and misusing Scripture. Have you ever had a bad boss? One of my craziest bad boss stories is from my years in working home health. I was a home health nurse, and one Friday afternoon while I was doing the job, a guy on 45 merged into my lane with a trailer and caused me to swerve into that left concrete thing over there and wrecked my car and flattened two of my tires. When I managed to limp off of the freeway, I found a nearby tire shop that eventually, after a couple of hours, put two tires on for me. I called my boss because it was Friday afternoon and I was on call for the weekend. I told her what had happened, and her words to me were not, "Are you all right?" They were not, "How's your car?" They were not, "Well, we'll get somebody to switch with you for a future weekend." Her words to me were, "You better get that straightened out. You're on call this weekend." Great. Appreciate it. Thanks for the help. You know, we have principles given in Scripture to us that we are to be good employers when we are in that position. God is putting just as much responsibility on the masters in this passage as he is the slaves. Now, I want to save verses 5 and 6 for the last today. They're pretty special, and so I want to skip on down to verse 7. We get to see further evidence of this good employer mandate in verse 7. Look there, please. When a man sells his daughter as a slave, she shall not go out as the male slaves do. Now, this is telling us that at the end of 6 years, she is to remain with the master and not leave his house. Again, you may be saying, "Hold the phone, Pastor Dan. How are you going to convince me that this is a good thing?" Here we have a dad selling his daughter into slavery. And yes, this is shocking to us as Westerners. It is. It doesn't really add up unless we know the cultural context for these verses. Now, keep in mind that God's desire in all of this was to protect women and children, to rehabilitate men, and to honor marriages. Slavery was meant to be voluntary, temporary. Its purpose was to lead people to freedom. And the same holds true in this verse here, believe it or not. The reason that a dad would sell his daughter is because he is very poor and the slave owner is very rich. And there's a possibility that one of the slave owner's sons would take notice of this fair maiden and take her as a wife. This was for the purpose of an arranged marriage, or at least the hope of one. And yet, we will still have some who say it remains unfair. The woman can't be set free at the end like the men can. And it's true that she must remain in that household. But again, culturally speaking, it is for her protection. A single woman out on her own would not have much of a chance of a good life. She's meant to be someone's wife in this culture. And so the slave owner retains her as a way of protecting her from unsavory characters. It assures her that she has a place to live and food to eat. Again, at the heart of this is the goodness of God. When you understand the cultural context, it becomes clear that God is defending his daughters. It's understandable that we would look on arranged marriage with disdain. That's just not how we do things in America. I understand that. But this was common. It was a common custom in this world. A marriage was arranged by the fathers, and the children went along with it. And this was just how it was done. And so, really, our opinion of that doesn't matter at all. We have to read the scripture and understand it based on what was happening in history at that time. We can't place our own values and customs onto the scripture. Truthfully, our own world in this day and age has some pretty wild and weird and wacky marriage customs, if the truth be told. I did a Google search this week, and you'd be appalled at what I found. I get to tell you here in just a minute. Take these wedding customs just as an example. In South Korea, there's the beating of the groom's feet. Groom's feet are beaten with a rope or, get this, with a fish. I can hardly tell that part. It's supposed to prove out the character of the groom. Man, I hope so. Kenya, there's marriage spitting. And the bride's father spits on the bride, on her face and on her chest. That's considered good luck over there. Scotland, there's what's called blackening. The groom and the bride-to-be are taken by their friends and rolled in soot and trash before their big day. In India, there's marrying a tree. The bride and the groom both marry a banana tree before their wedding to ward off bad spirits. In Germany, there's smashing pottery. Everybody shows up at the house of the bride, the house of the groom, and they smash crockery in their front yard. In China, there's the crying ritual. Starting a month before the wedding, a bride is to cry 10 minutes a day for her potential groom. After a few days, her mother and grandmother join in. That's a lot of caterwauling in one house. In France, there is the la pot de chambre. Yes, you guessed it, the chamber pot. The French used to drink out of the toilet to assure that they could survive anything after their marriage. That has been replaced, thankfully, by champagne and chocolate served in a pretend toilet. In Malaysia and Indonesia, there's Borneo's bathroom ban. The bride and the groom are not allowed to use the bathroom for 3 days following their wedding. They're not fed or given anything to drink. Welcome to Malaysia. Sweden, you may all kiss the bride. If the groom leaves the room during the reception, every other guy takes the big chance to go and smooch the bride. There you go, girls. Ah, somebody said. So the customs in the Bible really are just the start of customs we might find somewhat or totally offensive, right? Verse 8. If she does not please her master, who has designated her for himself, then he shall let her be redeemed. He shall have no right to sell her to a foreign people, since he has broken faith with her. If he designates her for his son, he shall deal with her as with a daughter. If he takes another wife to himself, he shall not diminish her food, her clothing, or her marital rights. And if he does not do these three things for her, she shall go out for nothing without payment of money. Now here we have three specific protections afforded to the maid servant. First, if the master's not pleased with her for himself or with her service, not considering her for marriage, then she'll be redeemed back to her family. Now keep in mind, the servant girl's not blamed for this. She doesn't suffer in any way. She simply goes back to her family. The loss is taken by the master here, who loses a servant, potential wife in the process. Not meant to shame the girl. It simply just didn't work out for the bride to be there. Second is if the son is pleased with her in verse 9, then she's to be treated then as a daughter. Now, I would imagine that this means that she's no longer treated as a servant, but rather as a part of that family. And so with all the rights and the privileges of that rich family now. So this would mean that life gets pretty good for her. She's no longer having to serve, and she's in this rich family where she was in a poor one before. And then the third final protection offered is in verses 10 and 11. If the son ends up taking a different wife, the master does for some reason, doesn't marry the girl, divorces the girl, she's to remain a part of the family with her share of provisions. She's to receive the same food allowance, same clothing allowance, same right to intimacy. Sometimes things didn't work out. And there's the breaking off of an engagement. There was a divorce. In these cases, the woman was not to be put away. She was to remain as a part of this family. And then in verse 11, if they just refuse to do anything, there to set her free. And so it really seems as if in every single scenario that the woman's being looked after, she's cared for no matter what. And culturally speaking, again, this was important. In our culture, we have, you know, the image of a strong, independent woman. There are women who say openly, I don't need no man taking care of me, right? And honestly, we have a culture and a society where a woman can make it on her own. The church, our church at least, likes to look after the ladies entrusted to us as a function of what we've been called to. Many times they can make it financially without help. But we also have a culture, our culture, that where women have been mistreated by men at every turn. They abuse them, they use them up without ever marrying them. And so it's no wonder, really, that some women in our society have such a dim view of men. The men in their lives have done nothing to deserve any kind of honor or respect. They've not earned the trust of the women in their lives. But I just want to say again, this is not the case in God's economy. God is insisting on his daughters having plenty to eat, having clothing, having their full rights to remarry, enjoy a life with kids. Provisions being made by God in every circumstance to see that they're taken care of in a way that fits with their culture of the time. Some people use the scripture to accuse God of being anti-woman, but I don't think you can use this particular set of verses to prove that out. I don't believe that. In every single instance, God's taking care of women and children. He's making sure they have what they need. I have an uncle in my family history who was worthless. He physically beat my aunt, who is now passed on. He was mean to his children, my cousins, one of them just a newborn. When my aunt had had all she could take, she called my dad, her brother. She told him what was happening and asked for his help. And my dad, to his credit, went to where she was, and when the man was gone, he went in and he packed up my aunt and he moved her out of town. They didn't tell the man where they were and he couldn't find them. Later, my dad relocated my aunt to Arkansas to be closer to her mom and dad, my grandparents, to begin life again. And she flourished there in Arkansas. She ran a chicken farm by herself for Tyson, raised three kids on that chicken farm. Life was better for her after that. You know, as men, we're to make sure that the women in our lives are well cared for. Our culture is different now. Oftentimes that sort of talk of, you know, just me even saying taking care of women is met with hostility from women who say they don't need help. They don't need a man. We as men should seek to protect anyway, regardless of how they might feel about it. We should respect. At the same time, make sure that sisters and aunts and female family members have what they need, even if it's from a distance. And in the church, we need to watch out for our single women here, regardless of their circumstance. We have those among us who are widowed, those who are still young and single, those who have been divorced. And I want to say to you this morning, ladies who are members of our church, it doesn't matter what your story is. You can count on us as a church to watch after you. We won't be intrusive about it, but you can always call on us for help if you need it. You can count on the men of this church to work on your house or your property if you need it. You can be assured that you will not go without anything that you need. That's a solemn promise. And some of you have experienced that yourself. James tells us that true religion is to look after widows and orphans. And we can extend that to practical widows and orphans as well. Those who are without your family, those without a husband for any reason at all, can count on your church, our church, to help you. It's what we're to be about. And so any guy here, if you hear from one of our ladies about needing help, you send up the alarm and we will be there. The final section we're covering deals with some very special circumstances. It's a beautiful set of verses between master and slave. Let's look back at verse 5 that we skipped a while ago. But if the slave plainly says, I love my master, my wife, my children, I will not go out free, then his master shall bring him to God. He shall bring him to the door or the doorpost, and his master shall bore his ear through with an awl, and he shall be his slave forever. Have you ever had a boss that you said about them, I love that guy, I think I'll work here forever? Most of us in this fallen world have not had that. But most of us have not had the benevolent masters that God is requiring in these verses today. If bosses today treated their employees the way God says is saying to treat these slaves, we'd probably have a lot better retention in the workforce. Companies who kept people working for them, unless they start chasing you around with a hammer and an awl, right? But provision is made here for a slave who loved their life, loved their master, loved their family, wanted to stay on forever to do so. There's a procedure here that's to be followed if the slave states his intentions to stay on with the master. And each part has a very specific purpose or meaning. The ceremony was to be a public ceremony. Right out in the open, the slave was said to be taken before God. In the eyes of God, in the eyes of his elders, he states his intentions. That statement made by the slave had to be emphatic according to the language of the verse. The literal translation of verse 5 says the servant truly declares. There's an emphatic declaration made. And once this declaration was made, then the servant was taken to the doorpost of the house in a symbolic gesture. His ear is pierced, symbolizing the part of his body that's meant to listen for his master's voice. It was done on the doorpost, attaching himself to his master's household. The blood that ran down from this act symbolized a covenant between master and slave. The slave voluntarily laid down his life in service of his master. And the reason given for this act is love. Love for his master. And how could a master engender so much attention and devotion? Why would a servant be enticed to give up his entire life in devotion to the master's cause? Well, this was the very best of masters. He was generous. He was kind. He looked after the interest of the servants as much as he did his own. It was only natural for the servant to love him in return. You beginning to see the spiritual side of all this? A clear picture of the gospel today. So much so that David even wrote about it in one of his psalms, Psalm 40. Sacrifice and meal offering you've not desired. My ears you have opened. I delight to do your will, O my God. Your law is within my heart. Where it says, my ears you have opened, it literally states, ears you have dug for me. It means that he's created ears that hear the voice of them, of him who gave those ears. When God opens our eyes and our ears to him, we gladly follow him for the rest of our days. Part of the answer to the first question of the Heidelberg Catechism that we study around here. Question 1, what is thy only comfort in life and in death? The answer says, The part of it says the Holy Spirit makes us sincerely willing and able to live for Him. You know, what's interesting is that the gospel message actually involves a master who became a slave on our behalf. Philippians 2 describes Christ becoming as a slave or a servant by taking on human flesh to redeem us. Mark chapter 10, Jesus says about Himself, "For even the Son of Man did not come to be served, but to serve, and to give His life a ransom for many." Paul tells us in 2 Corinthians, "He made Him who knew no sin to be sin for us, so that we might become the righteousness of God in Him." The whole story sort of gets flipped on its head as Jesus becomes like a servant for us. And so our best response to a master so benevolent, "Pierce my ear, Lord. Pierce my ear. I give my life, my service, my whole self to You forever." There's a story told about Abraham Lincoln, which may or may not have happened, but Lincoln was so involved with the slaves. Makes a powerful point either way. Lincoln was said to have gone to a slave auction where there he saw a young woman up for sale. He was appalled even at the fact that they were selling human beings. The young woman, she looked with hatred and contempt on all who passed by. She had been used and abused, and her prospects for the future were really no better. So Lincoln bid on her. Every time someone upped the bidding, Lincoln bid higher until he had won this young woman in this auction. At the end, he paid the auctioneer. He approached the young woman. She stared at him with vicious contempt. She asked him what he was going to do next with her. He said, "I'm going to set you free." "Free?" she asked. "Free for what?" "Just free," Lincoln answered. "Free to do what I want to do?" "Yes," he said, "free to do whatever you want to do." "Free to say whatever I want to say?" "Yes, free to say whatever you want to say." "Free to go wherever I want to go?" she asked with skepticism. Lincoln answered, "Young lady, you are free to go anywhere you want to go." "Then I'm going with you." It's for freedom Christ has set us free from a life of bondage, free from the bondage of sin, free from a life of degradation and slavery to other things. In Christ Jesus, we are free. It's right and fitting then that we tell Jesus, "I'm going with you." Let's pray together. Father, what powerful lessons You bring to us in the simplest of verses, Lord, on the treatment of slaves. We recognize, Father, that we were slaves and that You bought us before we even knew that we needed that. And so we thank You for it. We pray, God, that we will, Lord, live with the freedom of Christ in our hearts. And, Lord, that we will ask Him to truly pierce our ears and give a life of devotion to our benevolent Master. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen.